morning. My name is Professor Srikanth Vedantam. I'm a professor in Department of Engineering Design. I grew up on campus in IIT. I was born and brought up on campus, and that's partly the reason why we are having this discussion today. How about you?
My name is Aniruddhan, and I too grew up on the campus. From about 1978 to 2000, I spent my childhood on campus, part of which was also studying in the EE department. Now I am back in the EE department as a faculty member since 2011.
So in that case, I was born in 1972, and from then to 1993, when I did my undergraduate in mechanical engineering, I was on campus. And the first thing I think we have to start with is trying to talk about the differences since from then to now. And in one way, it looks pretty much the same. The campus hasn't changed. If you look at it, there are a few more new buildings, but the essential layout, the essential character is still there. At least I see it that way. The ways that it has changed is quite significant. For example, like some of the new buildings that we have for faculty quarters, and like the new shopping center, that's amazingly new and different from what we had then. How about you, Andres, and what do you think about that?
I totally agree. I think the main landmarks are kind of set you in space, right? The ad block, the stadium, the location of these things are pretty much the same as before.
Gajendra Circle, OAT.
So the main landmarks of IIT campus are all in the same place. But of course, once when I came in 2011, the new C2 type quarters had near shopping center had just been constructed. So that was kind of stood out when I was coming on Delhi Avenue. So that was a big change. But at that time, apart from that, I think I had been away from the campus for about 11 years. So that was probably the number one thing that stood out. The next thing that stood out was, of course, when I went to the hostel section after some time, just to show, just to look at it for myself. And then by then, the two new hostels had come up near SAC. So that was also something new. But apart from that, it felt like home. Once we moved back into campus, kind of reoriented myself into the same space.
Yeah. So moving from the residential zone to the hostel as you did, I also found that to be one of the big differences. Of course, the fact that there was one major mess for everybody. Hostel life for me was like quite a minimal since I was on campus. I used to just go back home. I had a room in Narmada Hostel, but I hardly used it. In fact, the only memory I have about it is I put a number lock on it and my friend spent a lot of time trying to crack it. But the common mess is still going out and hanging out with friends in the hostel rooms and going to the mess there. That part, definitely that hostel life seems to have changed in that fashion quite a bit. Then, of course, in terms of the going to the academic zone, which was a little bit away from our worldview as we were growing up. The only thing I remember about academic zone when I was growing up as a little kid was bicycling down near the aero department and seeing that little plane which was there. Like lots of times we used to go there and keep watching it, and like of course cycling to the various other academic zone. But of course some of the new buildings like engineering design department itself is a new thing since then.
That's right. So I too remember, I think so I studied in Kendri Vidyalaya. So I remember after school taking a walk to the aero department and playing with the with the plane sitting in the, I used to be small enough at that time to get into the cockpit.
Yeah, I used to get
so it was outside on display. It was like pretty interesting, lot of fun seeing that. And of course, when I was young, I used to mainly go to the EE department, not the other departments, not so much, but EE department definitely used to visit a lot. And as far as the new hostel seems to have come up between 2000 and 2011. So that was also new for me. They had cleared out that space when I was studying. So I actually used to be in Mandakini Hostel. So second, third and half of the fourth year I spent there. So I used to spend most of the week, about once a week, once in the middle of the week I would come. Of course, the weekend I would spend at home. Part of it was because my father felt it quite important that I get a sense of living in the hostel, away from family. And because especially towards the end, I also wanted to go for higher studies, move out of Chennai for higher studies. So he felt it was important for me to, you know, learn to live a little bit more independently. Even though I'm sure at that stage he felt he wanted, you know, me to stay more at home. He felt both my parents felt it important that I stay away.
So that's it. And then going back to again school, for example, that's the other thing I think we can like really talk about, because I studied in Vanwani all my life. So starting from LKG up to 12th standard, it was Vanwani all the way. And at that point in time, the school was actually a very good school. It was a well sought after school in the campus. In the city, entire city. In fact, everybody used to really want to come and join it. So it was I still have very good friends from my school days who I'm in touch with. Excellent facilities, the great playground, very nice labs, because they used to get a lot of the lab equipment from the discarded equipment from physics labs here and chemistry labs here. So it was a fantastic experience even going to school in Vanwani. And I think Aniruddhan.
Yes, so I studied, of course, kindergarten in Vanwani. Luckily, it was just almost back door from my house. So it was just about 50 meters from my house. And so LKG, UKG, I studied there. From first standard to 12th standard, I studied in Kendriya Vidyalaya. So we used to cycle down. Once I reached a certain age, I learned how to cycle. And I used to cycle down from home to here with no problem. Again, it was considered to be, one of the, both Kendriya Vidyalaya and Vanavani were considered to be among the best schools in Chennai. And they are still maintaining it from what I can see. They are still maintaining it till today, right? I still see, you know, when they rank the schools, the best schools are here. Earlier, it used to be, you know, there were less number of schools outside, and even then they used to maintain it. And part of it was we also felt safe, right? Going to school, no traffic, very little traffic on the IIT Madras roads. So we felt very safe, you know, bicycling down on the roads and
So in that sense, of course, we had a lot of friends from both schools. So always we had a good idea of what was going on in both schools, and like we had friends there. And so when you mentioned traffic, of course, that raises an interesting thing. So when we were growing up, clearly the city in Adyar and outside was clearly is not as traffic intensive and developed, so to speak, as right now. But yet, even then, because we were ensconced in such a safe environment as IIT, even then, the traffic outside used to be formidable. I remember lots of time my parents, cautioning me about how to ride my bicycle outside, and in fact, preventing me from doing so. I used to have to take the bus or the auto lots of times. And considering that, now things have probably, gone up by a factor of even 1,000, I would say. And we still feel the same kind of safe environment in the campus, and we feel that little thing outside.
Flyover outside the institute?
There was no flyover outside the gate, exactly. So that is something that came up later.
In fact, I remember when I was very, very young, the IIT bus used to go to Adyar. Yes. Because there were only a few buses flying through Sardar Patel Road. The IIT bus used to go till the last bus stop was Adyar bus stop.
Adyar signal also?
Signal also. So It used to go till the signal, make a U-turn around the Avan Park, the Muthulakshmi Reddy Park, and then come back down. Right? Correct. So it used to go till Adyar signal and then make a U and come back.
So after that, of course, Adyar, the entire phase of Adyar has changed. And so that's another interesting thing that we recall from when we were growing up.
What was your participation in events like Mardi Gras or maybe Sarang even by your time? Science fair?
Yeah, I can start with that because I have very good memories of Mardi Gras. So, in fact, it was Mardi Gras till the time I graduated. So, 1993 was when I graduated. It was still called Mardi Gras by then. I think the following year, the name of the event changed. And it was really considered a very good event. I used to go there to that event even as a school kid. So, even as, of course, I wouldn't participate in the events, but there were lots of little, fair-like activities, throw your ring on the object and see if you can pick it up. I used to participate in a lot of those as a school kid from Vanwani as well. So certainly, and of course, 89 to 93, Mardi Gras was, a fantastic thing. I remember it very well, and with a lot of fond memories. And the thing I remember about it, which is different from now Sarang, is the final day was the Mardi Gras quiz. And it was a really big event. I mean, it was the grand finale. Quiz questions used to be very difficult, but in a sense, after the answer was told to you, they were kind of obvious. In that sense, they kept the audience interest very much so. And so that was the grand finale. Now I notice that it's no longer the finale of the thing. So that is the key thing I remember from Mardi Gras.
So I participated a little bit, but probably not too much in Mardi Gras. I think 94, 95 was when the name changed to Sarang. So by the time I joined IIT Madras, the name had already changed to Sarang. But I didn't see, the events changed over time. So when I was very young, I had the same experiences. So you would go to the stalls and maybe to the, classical music show, right? Things like that. And the quiz, as he says, the quiz was definitely, yes, very, very interesting to us as high school kids as well as undergraduate. That was the big event of Mardi Gras as far as we were concerned.
At that point in time, That was the...
Who was the quiz master? Do you remember?
It would change. So we had professional quiz masters also come in sometimes. But sometimes it was even conducted by our own...
Subramaniam of RSIC, chemistry
professor. Yes, he used to conduct it some years. Yes, you are absolutely right. He used to conduct it. In fact, one time we even had Basu.
Siddhartha Basu
also, correct. He came in once to conduct. So it was in that sense, it was considered very But lots of times we had even our own quiz team also conducted. But you're absolutely right, Professor Subramani, I remember him also conducting it.
Who was the quiz master who was the old boy of Kendra?
Siddhartha Basu.
Siddhartha Basu was the, correct, he's right.
He was also a national figure in quizzing.
Yes.
So
that is right. He was an alumnus of Kendriya Vidyalaya.
They had to conduct in SAC building once.
That's
when
right.
Conducted
this,
So in that sense, but the other interesting thing was, I don't know if you participated in it, but we used to go to Gerard Fisher and Kokla Rajay also with as much interest.
Yes.
So in the period of about, 83 to 86, IIT Madras had a very good basketball team. And so it used to be a thing of excitement, we would go support our home team and stay up pretty late, even for the finals, come back home, get scolded for staying up that late. It used to be one of those, it's very fond memories of going there and watching, supporting a cricket team.
So this used to take place in OIT, right?
It used to be played, the finals used to be played in OIT, and a lot of other matches also. So Venu and Satya's classmate, they all used to be in that team. It used to be a great basketball team. So very good memories of that as well.
Do you recall an open house that was held in the
80s? Yes, I do. I did go around the stalls. In fact, I remember even then, the high voltage lab had this huge lightning generator, which is, I still remember it going around. It was amazing. That is an amazing sight. There were, I think, maybe, I remember one at least, but maybe there were one or two more. I don't remember that. But yes, did go to the open house. Very fond memory.
Also about the aeronautics, they used to allow you to enter the aircraft and then...
That was also one of the highlights of growing up. So then, I think the other thing as campus kids we used to participate is, of course, OAT.
Yes.
So we used to go for, at that point in time, it used to be only English movies.
Yes.
Every Saturday.
Every week.
And in the sense, the student participation was also very high. The OAT was completely filled up because I guess now people have alternative means of getting their movies, but then it was only the only one. So we used to go and remember lots of times when it was raining, we would just hold up a chair above our head and just keep watching the movie and come back home and get scolded for getting wet. I don't know if you've done that.
No, absolutely. Many, many times. Because, taking the chair next to you and holding it over your head. Because as young kids, we will forget to take the umbrella. Or maybe your parents, if they take the umbrella, we'll probably say, hey, it's not going to rain. But we'll end up taking the chair and hold it on top of our heads. Those used to be the metal chairs. Nowadays, it's the plastic chairs.
Yeah.
Today, the plastic chairs don't give you a lot of protection because they have these, openings in the middle. But in the early days, it uses the metal chair a little bit better protection.
At least in our eyes, but not certainly in the parents'
eyes.
You'd still get wet. So that is the other thing. And then other campus facilities that we used to really use is the swimming pool. I've gone and taken lessons there several times. Each time, lessons will start afresh. But This is a great school, great pool. I mean, it's even now I would say it's definitely a great facility. Even then, it was just a fantastic facility.
And possibly the library too, or something that you use?
So library, as school kids, we did not have much access to a library, no. So only as undergraduate students, of course, I spent a lot of time in the library, but not, right?
That's right.
But in an inter-IIT sports or cultural activities?
Actually, no. Surprisingly enough, I did play for IIT. I played tennis. And I was in the basketball team, at least the second team I was there. But somehow when it came to inter-IIT, I never traveled with the team somehow. I used to go for, I've represented IIT tennis in Vivekananda College and so on. But never outside, I've not gone on tours or anything like that.
I think both your parents were playing tennis in the club.
My dad never did actually. He used to just go mostly for a walk. He never played tennis.
My father used to play tennis. Actually, in between, in the 90s, the present day Tech Kids Crash, that area, a ladies club had actually built a tar court there.
Correct.
I don't know, we used to go play.
We did
as kids.
Yes. Yes, I did too.
Correct.
Basketball, and later they even had a tennis.
They even had a tennis court.
Tennis
That's
court
right.
there.
That's right. Now so it's become Tech Kids now.
Tech Kids, yes, yes. So, yeah, so that is the other thing. But in terms of cultural events, I mostly only participated in Mardi Gras events and of course the inter-hostel events definitely. So I still have some certificates about inter-audiovisual quiz, winning the audiovisual quiz or something like that. So some of those events, yes.
It was a beautiful campus to grow up in. So did you spend time roaming around looking at the lake and going on walks in those areas, exploring the forest?
Oh yes, certainly. Lots of times we used to just go into the forest and just try to see if we're exploring. Especially when we were younger, definitely. We used to go and we walk near the lake. We used to do all of that a lot. The Veeranam project was going on then, actually, when I was a kid. The Veeranam project is a way of connecting the Veeranam lake to Chennai to get the water supply. So they used to have these huge 6 feet diameter pipes, which are all lying around there. So lots of time was spent in just playing on those pipes, climbing on top of them and going through them. Yes, so that was another fond memory of growing up.
You know, what happened as a result of that Veeranam pipes was that IIT would have had a boat club. There was a lake in the 60s, and because the Veeranam pipes were put, the entire thing got blocked. It was supposed to go via Taramani Gate.
Okay.
Outside.
I see.
And finally the project did not take off that way. And as a school student, did you not participate in an event in OIT? You used to have an annual day.
Yes.
Annual
so
day.
Every one of our annual days and sports days.
Yeah.
So sports days used to be in stadium all the time. Yeah. And annual day for one money was always in OIT. And yeah, we did participate in a lot of these dramas and so on there, skits and so on.
So by the time I was in high school, a lot of our sports days always was in stadium. The annual day started moving to SAC. I think because it's an indoor, by the early 90s, we used to have most of our annual days in SAC. Earlier, when I was very young, it used to happen in OIT, I remember. But we had moved to SAC, but SAC was not AC'd. It was still relatively open, but it was a big enough venue still. It was the biggest venue. So, and I used to take place in dramas, things like that, songs, dramas, things like that as part of the school annual days.
Yeah.
Right.
And as you grew up, then there was always this interest in joining IIT as a student.
Yes.
So how did being on campus affect those ambitions?
I can relate some of that as well because, so definitely the first most important aspect was that there were several seniors who keep getting in every year, just ahead of you. So my seniors by 2 years, 1 year, they had a lot of effect on me because, they had just gotten that excitement of them having gotten their ranks and so on. It used to rub off on us. We used to go and discuss things like that. Some of my friends' brothers had also studied for JEE and gotten and all that. So that used to kind of have a big picture role in terms of how we were studying for it. The second aspect was, of course, we had also a group of friends amongst us who were all very keen on getting in. So every evening we would, along with, after finishing up playing, we would start talking about, you know, what are the various things that we have to do, what they had done, whether we could also take something back from that. So yes, they did play a big role. There was a lot of discussion, excitement, and talking about it that happened, especially in our starting from 11th and 12th year. At that point in time, it was not, 10th and 9th, we never really worried about it. It started really in right earnest only in 11th and 12th, really. So.
And you were mentioning there were some coaching classes.
Yes, so we used to have coaching classes in Vanwani School, about 6 days a week. So 2 days we'd have for maths, physics and chemistry. And we'd had professors who were teaching in colleges outside, maths, physics, chemistry. I believe long ago IIT professors used to do part of this coaching. But then what I heard is that they brought a rule saying IIT professors cannot coach for JEE. So people from outside colleges, so they would get together and organize it the days such that they'd come on alternate days. So the classes used to take place in the evenings from about 6 to 8 or so, couple of hours a day. And again, even till our time, till the mid-90s, coaching used to start only in 11th standard. 11th and 12th is when we used to study for coaching. And I think I was so my own understanding of this is that from the 70s to 90s, there was a big, I think because the first set of professors who joined, their children had reached the age, or a good population. I think IIT probably saw a lot of faculty growth in the late 60s, early 70s, if I'm not mistaken. And so their children reached the point where 80s and 90s was kind of, there are a lot of children growing up on campus together who are applying for JEE. And writing JEE. So we used to hear, right? So these people, we used to follow about 10 years before us. And these people, this person, they are studying, they got into this branch, they got this JEE rank. So in 11th and 12th, it was a big deal for us.
Yeah.
And you had siblings too?
Yes. So yeah, in my case, two of my brothers also, my eldest brother is 5 years older than me and the other guy is 2 years older than me. So yeah, in my case, both of them also studied in IIT. So I also had that to kind of, a little bit of added pressure, you could say, in my case.
Okay. So at least I didn't have that one. My sisters did not go to undergrad here. They went to master. They did their masters here in IIT in computer science and chemical engineering, respectively. Two sisters, elder sister.
Three and three.
Yes.
When did you appear for JEE?
I appeared in 1996.
96? Yes. What about you?
I in 1989.
89, is
yes,
it?
Yes.
Oh, I see. So you are the same batch as Sundar Pichai.
Yes, actually Sundar Pichai was my classmate in Vanwani.
Oh, yeah. In 11th and 12th. Because Vanwani school.
Correct. He was my classmate in Vanwani
school. Are you in touch with him?
No, not really. Even then, actually, he was in a different section in biology. To know each other, but we were not very like.
He was in a biology, is it?
He was in biology, 11th and 12th.
The fellow then became computer scientist. I see.
Yes.
No, but of course, he went to IIT. So amongst the Vanwani group who got into IIT at that point in time, there were only four of us. So one friend, Siva Subramaniam, who was Professor Yagnarayana's son, like electrical engineer Yagnarayana's son, he was my classmate. Me, then Sundar, and one more friend of ours, Ganesh. So only four of us got into IIT. So Sundar happened to go to Kharagpur and
from those who studied in Central School, one of them happened to be a son of a physics professor,
Hari Balakrishnan. Yes, Hari, he was my batch as well, yes. Hari is a good friend, we are in touch, yes. So Hari Balakrishnan he's a good friend. So of course, so there were other few students who also came from campus and
when the JEE was conducted, the results were announced 2 months later.
Actually, that's right. Our year was a special year where the faculty went on strike after JEE.
See, 88, the trouble started. So I could avoid it for 10 days. 10 days it was extended. We announced the results on 10th of June. That's why it used to be 1st of June. So then 89, I think Kanpur organized, they couldn't control. There was a staff agitation.
Yes.
In fact, 88, I was the organizing chairman, IIT Madras. Okay. So something happened, I could control them, but 89 I think could be done.
That's right. So our results got delayed by a lot.
Our
classes started only on September 4th. And for the first semester, we had classes on Saturdays as well to make up for all of that. So, and yeah, there was lots of, so because of that, in fact, you know, a whole bunch of our classmates who joined here, we had gotten also, you know, admission in Roorkee.
Uh-huh.
So we all traveled to Roorkee on the same train, like a whole bunch of about 40 of us. We all traveled to Roorkee and we enrolled in Roorkee at that point in time.
Oh, I see.
So within a week or 10 days, probably a week later, we got the IIT results and the whole bunch, we came back. So in fact, in Roorkee is where I met all my classmates, I mean, lots of them. So who eventually became my classmates here. We all joined Roorkee, a whole bunch we moved out. So I'm sure IIT, University of Roorkee at that point was very upset. So that is a very interesting event that happened there.
And do you know there was a change in the curriculum of JEE in 88 onwards?
Uh-huh.
What is that?
English paper. We did write English, yeah. Yes.
And then it continued till you appeared, I think. Like only three papers you had.
Yes, we had only three papers. Yeah. We had only three papers, Maths, Physics and Chemistry.
Right. And you had only, you didn't have that preliminary and that's one.
So in my year, they were just transitioning. So in my year, what they did was they had an objective section and the subjective section. They were held at different times, but they were combined. So I think there was 30 marks for objective and 70 marks for subjective. And they used it for both screening as well as for the overall marks, if I remember correctly. My memory is a little bit hazy on that part, but if I remember right, they did an initial screening using the objective section, but then used it for the ranking.
Okay, now you can tell about the teachers that you taught to in various
subjects. Oh yes, definitely. Yeah. Like, you know, I can go forward. So first, our first exposure was to the physics department, chemistry and maths, of course, because we had the courses in that. We had excellent teachers. I really remember like lots of teachers fondly. Professor P.C. Deshmukh from physics, he taught us physics. I mean, and our batch, of course, Professor V. Balakrishnan from physics, yeah, and Professor Srinivasan from physics were held in high esteem. Unfortunately, our section, they didn't teach, but whenever possible, we used to try to bunk our own class and go and sit in the PHLT to sit in their class just for, you know, getting that, like, so in a sense they really held a very high level in our eyes. And then we had excellent maths teachers also. Professor Subramaniam in maths taught us. Professor Purushottam, CM Purushottam, he was our maths teacher, excellent maths teacher. And so in chemistry also we had really very good teacher. So then we went into the department, of course, we had also very good teachers. Professor Ajit Kohler stands out in my mind, he transferred, and several other teachers. Even now, Professor, like for example, currently Professor Ramesh in manufacturing, he taught me courses. Mm-hmm. So I remember his courses very well. Professor Ashok Junjunwala taught us E-Tech 2, I remember. Professor Jagdish Kumar, Electrical Engineering, taught us E-Tech 1. I remember their courses also very nicely, very fondly. And some of the other teachers who made a big impact is Professor T.T. Narendran.
Oh, yeah.
Professor T.T. Narendran and Professor G. Srinivasan, they used to teach a course on operation research. Somehow, it really like caught the imagination of a lot of my classmates. And in fact, even now, I would say about 10% of my class has gone into OR just because of their influence. So I also remember that course very well. We really... it was an elective, but we would go there and we'd really get challenged. So these are some of the courses I really remember fondly from our undergrad days.
So in my case, mathematics, Professor Kulkarni, he taught me maths 2, I think. Then Professor Rangan, A. Rangan, he taught me maths 3 and 4, so I remember. Professor Srivastava taught me maths 1. So maths, we had four courses of mathematics at that time. Then in physics, we had Professor Bulusu Subramaniam. He taught us physics 1 and 2. And then we had a quantum physics course for the electrical engineers alone, I think, or only one or two branches had it. Professor M.V. Satyanarayana, he taught us physics 3. Chemistry, it was mostly handled by Professor B. Vishwanathan. So he kind of taught us chemistry. And then humanities. So humanities, we had a, I think, I took in my year, so what they did was I wanted to study German, but there was a lot of demand for German. So I couldn't get German 1, so I did German later. I took a history course by Professor Dilip Veeraraghavan. So that is one of my, you know, big memories, because he had a very different style from humanities. Already the way of exposition is very different from other classes, but also it was lot, you know, it was mainly oral. So it was very, very different way of teaching. And then after that, I also took a like a philosophy course in my final year by Professor Subramaniam from the humanities department. It was called German studies, but it was more towards German philosophy. And then in the EE department, I was taught by, of course, lot of professors who are still there. First set of courses, Professor Jagadish Kumar and Professor P.C. Maji taught our batch, first course. Second set of courses, Professor Bhaskar Ramamurthy, our present director, so he's one of my teachers. Then Professor Jalihal, who's now the HOD of the EE department. So I think I was that batch where the senior professors in the department right now, almost all of them have taught me. Professor Aravind, Professor Giridhar, I didn't take any of his courses, but he taught, you know, he taught my my classmates. So most of the people, you know, who are senior professors in the department have taught me.
Yeah, I've got also, you reminded me of humanities also. Economics, we had a course, and we really enjoyed that. Professor Malathi taught us that. And German, Professor B. Subramaniam, I also took it. I always used to try out different languages. So I took French in 11th and 12th, and then German and thing. I mean, I was not very good in any of the languages, but it is not for the lack of trying. Let me put it that way. So then, we had some very good humanities courses as well. I never took Professor Dilip Veeraraghavan's course, but he used to hang around his office anyway. You know, a lot of our students used to just go and hang out around his office. He would have like lots of interesting things to tell us all the time. So that is a very good memory of Professor Dilip Veeraraghavan. And I have to mention one more thing is my current colleague, Professor Krishnakumar, who is actually founding head of the department of our Department of Engineering Design, which was not there when we were there. I mean, it only started in 2006. He was actually a teacher in mechanical engineering. So I spent actually a summer doing a project with him, but I never took any of his courses, but I interacted him with that in that way. So now when I came back here, it's good to have him as a colleague here.
But you had a chief design engineer in mechanical engineering even when you joined, 89, Mr. Channapasappa.
Yes.
And he later, you know, he took, just before he retired, he took his doctorate degree.
Yes.
Professor Velu Swamy also was in engineering design. Yes.
So. In fact, yes, Professor Channapasappa's, Dr. Channapasappa's son was also my classmate. So,
I see.
Professor Velu Swamy's son was my junior by a few years. Maybe he might be
Shivaselvan was 2 years senior to me.
Senior to you, okay. But he was my violin compatriot. We used to play violin together.
So. Oh, I see.
That's how I knew. Oh,
I didn't. I see. Oh, you are a violinist.
Well, yes. Good. Somebody tried teaching me a violin, but I don't know if I learnt it or not. So I can only put it that way.
So I think, if I remember right, Shivaselvan and I had the same. I also learnt vocal and violin.
Okay.
I think Shivaselvan and I had the same violin teacher too.
Who? Mr. Ragendar?
No. His name was Nagendra Rao.
Nagendra Rao.
You also learned from him?
I learned from him as well.
Oh,
yes.
I see. Correct.
Both are violinists.
So. I wouldn't say violinist, I would say attempted violinist.
Same here.
So. No, it's always good to have a hobby, you know.
Yes. But it has stayed on in the sense that we've gotten into the music scene a lot. So, for example, you know, there used to be this Tyagaraj Aradhana that used to be conducted on campus every year. So, by Professor S.P. Venkateshan, Mrs. S.P. Venkateshan, Professor Ajit Kolar. It was to go from home to home. So, every year, January, February, March, around that time. One Saturday or Sunday would be spent Tyagaraja Aradhana. So we would always participate. We would go in the morning and listen to everything till the evening, till the afternoon. So that used to be one of the standard things on campus.
So did you participate in the music club activities as well?
In my case, not so much. I think probably IIT Music Club, I used to attend the concerts. But I think I was not very closely involved with the music club itself.
So, yeah, I used to go for concerts, but it started mainly after I became an undergraduate student. Yeah. So, I, like, you know, I actually, I first started off getting interest by taking my mother for the concerts. And then eventually I started recognizing ragas and everything. So, then I realized, okay, this is how it works. And then I used that opportunity to, of course, influence some of my classmates. So I made them also a complete music nuts after by the end of the fourth year. So in that sense, participation was going and attending. I did also participate in violin in Mardi Gras like competitions, classical music competitions. But if I can put it like, you know, my participation in a very modest way, after my particular performance, the judge took the opportunity to congratulate the accompanist, mridangam player, more than he judge didn't talk about me and said, oh, the mridangam player very played very well. Thank you very much. And then I'm like, okay, I understand. I can read between the lines there. So that is the interesting thing.
But did you take the violin when you went abroad?
I did. And I tried continuing, practicing even in the US.
No, just for a change, you know, whenever feel.
I did. Especially when I was doing my PhD. 1 year, I just wanted to see if I can take it to the next level. So I just decided to take only 3 or 4 kritis and practice for 1 year. Just practice them in and out. So I said I'll go to practice every day just to take 3 or 4 kritis. So it didn't matter. Sometimes, you know, during PhD, I used to come back home at 3:30, 4 from the lab. Didn't matter. Even then, I would close the room. I'd practice for half an hour, like relatively softly. And then at the end of it, I wanted to try out how well I've improved. So I went to the most neutral observer I could think of, naturally my mother. And I said, I'll play, tell me how it sounds. So I played it. And you can imagine the most unbiased observer. My mother says, I think you need a little bit more practice. So that's when I realized maybe it's not in me.
Have you kept records of your violin?
No.
Why should you not? You should have kept.
Sometime I'll pick it up, but now my interests have gone into, I'm learning Sanskrit and I teach.
It's all right.
That's taking up a lot of my time.
So. Okay.
How's it back to be in your department, as on the other side of the table, as it were?
Yes.
What is it like
now? So I think as far as my interaction with the other faculty, my own teachers, right? So EE department in general has become fairly informal. I don't think any of my teachers, you know, present, my teachers from that time who are my colleagues now, they have never make me, you know, they never make me feel as if I've been the student and there has to be a, you know, I can't make myself expressed. I can't express myself completely. So I think that part is great. Now from as far as my interaction with the students go, yeah, definitely I think I sometimes think when I have to, let us say, you know, advise the students to do in a particular fashion, I definitely have to think back, you know, to my student days and think back whether I would have, you know, listened to the teacher or, you know, listened to what they say. But I mean, as always, I say, you know, do as I say and not as I did in the past, right? That's the way I look at it. But in general, the students, what my own feeling is, yeah, the students, you know, a good section of the students are as interested as they always were in studies. A good section of students are always as interested as they were in other pursuits also, hobbies, you know, music, quizzing, etc. I don't see a very, very big difference, in that portion. I think actually the students have gotten a lot more comfortable expressing, interacting with the faculty members, and I think that thing I do see, that there seems to be a change. I don't know if your experience is slightly different.
Yeah, on the whole, I agree with you that the very bright students, there are several of them, and I can remember some of my classmates, and like I can relate this sort of cohort with that cohort. But on the whole, I do notice a small difference in the attitude. I think this is it could be a generational thing, or it could be just the society itself has changed a little bit. But for example, in our cohort when we were there, like, you know, there used to be people who were like extremely focused on like, you know, completely tangential things. There would be one person who was a mathematician par excellence, so just like interested in very high mathematics. Similarly, physics, there would be a person. And we used to really appreciate and really look up to them for their abilities in that subject. Somehow this time I don't see that everybody like they look at their own individual interests, and I don't see like some of these common things being elevated. So we used to say, okay, that man, that we used to have this slang, for example, gay is a cat.
Cat, yes.
So once that's the highest praise, you know, like we really genuinely respected somebody who was a cat. Okay,
correct.
Cat.
I agree.
So now
that.
I'm not sure. I don't see the same thing. You know, there'll be somebody who's very accomplished, but the rest of the students don't really view it with the same kind of
awe that we
awe. Exactly, the awe is just used that's to be there. True. So that that's is one note thing I noticed. Then the cat. There's a funda guy. We used to keep saying that. Like, you know, like so every batch there would be one person who's called funda. Like a fun, he's a fundu or funda or something like that. That would be the nickname. So that part is a little bit, missing. And I thought as a former student here that I would have a lot more connection with the students. Maybe I don't. That could be just the generational gap. You know, you see somebody older than you, you tend to not believe what they're saying the first cut. I think that part is okay.
Were you sort of founding faculty member of your department? It's one of the newest departments, isn't it?
True, but no, I was not. I joined in about 4 years after it started, and I would say most of my colleagues were already here. That's the reason, because I went and spent several years as assistant professor outside, so I joined at associate professor level.
Can you place on record the history of your department?
Yes, yeah, certainly. So, Department of Engineering Design apparently founded in 2007. First in 2006 as a program, and the following year as a department. So the idea is that, you know, while engineering design is done by every department, electrical engineering, chemical, mechanical, everybody has to do design at the end of it. But the previous emphasis on an undergraduate education was more on the analysis. So as a mechanical engineer, when I graduated, you give me any part, I could analyze it very well and tell you, you know, what's going on, what's not going on well. But if you ask me to design, those principles were at least not emphasized too much. I mean, there were courses on that. So this department started off with the idea that every course that is taught, the engineering science and analysis aspect would be, the emphasis would be reduced a little bit, but the design aspects would be emphasized a little bit more. So that's how you can see that while we have the same courses, basic courses, mechanical and electrical, the emphasis of the courses is a little bit more on the applied aspects right away. So 2007, so right now we have about 15 faculty. The faculty range in background from mechanical, electrical. We have a couple of physics background faculty as well. The idea is to get a very interdisciplinary kind of environment where students can be exposed to the mechanical aspects of design, electrical aspects of design, and so on. So this is basically the. The founding professor in our department is Professor Krishnakumar. He was a professor in Department of Mechanical Engineering, and he was tasked by Professor Ananth to set up the curriculum and start the program. And so he was the first faculty member. And then he was joined by very soon, within a few months, by Professor Ashokan and Professor Nilesh Vasa. So they are the initial faculty. So and since then we have grown to about 15 faculty members right now, and we have most of our courses are self-contained. They're taught in our own department. Of course, we have common courses with maths and physics and chemistry, just like everybody else. So this is
the question for both of you: where the engineering design building is there now?
Yes.
What was the building there earlier?
It was, I think, the NCC building.
And that is admission office also.
Admission office also was there, is
yeah,
it? Okay, that I can remember.
Remember?
The reason is I was actually participating in NCC, so I used to go there at that point in time.
Correct.
Do you remember Professor Venugopal, electrical engineering?
Yes, yes, yes.
I see. Have you?
I met him several times.
Okay, you know, his nephew, who was also a graduate from here, was being taught by Lalgudi Jairaman and
Wiley. Oh, I see, okay.
His brother's son. And Jairam, Professor Venugopal performed his daughter's marriage in the hostel quadrangle.
Ah, interesting. Very interesting.
The only marriage which has performed in the hostel quadrangle.
Very interesting. That's,
Now, I have one question for you. Sure. After where the at one of those biotechnology departments are there, there was a building where your father was working after he retired. Do you remember that building?
Yes. So, my father, Professor VMK Shastri, he had this building called Regional Center for Energy, Heat and Mass Transfer, RCHMT. It was built in, it was located where the current biotech second building is.
Oh, I see. Okay. That was the corner building, and he worked for some time. In fact, he had even received a mail meant for me. And then he called and then sent it. And do you have, or you ask your father, whether he has a photograph of that building?
Certainly, I'll try to
see that building no longer exists, like the admission building.
Yes, yes. So I'll try to get one.
Please ask him.
It was supposed to be actually built on some more, it was supposed to be built by trying to save, save energy, and there was lots of this thought process that went.
No, because the interest for that was taken by Arkad Ramchandran.
Exactly. Professor Ramchandran was the
guiding force. And they started a chair in his name, Ramchandran's chair. But then somehow the center got closed.
Yes. So the building got closed. Center is still running.
Center
A.R. Balakrishnan was leading that center till he retired, or maybe even now he is, as far as I know. So the center is still running. So it's Professor based on Professor A. Ramchandran's initiatives.
And where is the center now?
It's in a building called the CFT building beside aerospace.
Oh, I see. Separate.
It's a small. There's a small office there. From there, they're running still the joint. That they run from there.
So. Is your father in India or is he?
Yes, my father. My parents are right now. They live in Kasturbanagar, just outside.
Because he didn't come to receive some sort of memento in August. So August or September in
August, the September they were in the US. They had just came back from the US in September.
And any other remembrances of your good old days as a child and then as a student?
So I think one thing I remember, the astronomy club used to be pretty active in the 80s. So I remember in 1986. Halley's Comet was going past the Earth. It comes approximately once every 76 years, if I'm not mistaken. So, they had actually set up a telescope on top of the on the terrace of the ad block here, and for a period of several weeks, you could go up in the middle of the night to the terrace. So you'll have student volunteers. Who will tell you to how to identify and so on. I think that because the next one is coming in 2061, I think so the chance of maybe this is the only chance for me to see that, that thing. I was about 7 or 8 years old at the time. I very distinctly remember this, right? Similarly, the astronomy club used to be very active. They used to, every few weeks they would, focus on, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn. So these are all things. So they used to have a fairly professional telescope set up where you could go up and, they would explain to you what to look for, where to look for and so on. They would focus on different things. And that was very interesting to me as a young kid.
Right.
So that was, other thing. There are certain events conducted by the students where we could participate even as campus kids. We used to go for an occasional hostel day, for example. At that time, it was if parents are invited, they would be inviting the family as well. So we would go and participate in some of the hostel days as well and so on.
I don't know if you remember, long ago in the 80s and even till the 90s, I guess, during Holi, the North Indian students who used to celebrate Holi, they would come around the faculty members' houses and to play with the, to put color on the faculty members and their families, to put color pot. I don't see that happening. It kind of slowly started dying out in the late 90s. Now I don't see it happening ever. So we used to have students, for example, my father's students, used to come from the hostel. They used to come to, you know, several faculty members' houses. So I still remember it because, you know, we were all young kids, probably like, you know, 6 or 7 years old. You know, we would like put on older clothes so that our the color doesn't stay on. So we would wait for them, right, on that day. So it was fun for us because, you know, Holi is a very colorful event. South India, it's not very common, but, you know, we still used to wait for the students to come and put it on us.
No, in fact, the campus, I mean the ladies club or the staff club, they used to arrange all the children. Yes. They used to call and right. provide the colors and all.
Yes.
Yeah. I think when you were a kid, I
yes, we did really participate so. A little bit in that. Yes, that used to be another thing.
So and no, that's why I am already interfering with.
Okay.
Anything else you would like to say about the campus, or I've asked about your, regarding him, I know his father.
Right,
we were together in Germany for some time, so I met him in Germany, so.
Definitely, it was a unique experience, you know, growing up on campus and then of course studying here. Coincidentally, both of us happened to do that and then coming back to, so I always look back on one particular thing that, for 8 o'clock classes, I used to bicycle and used to be really fast to try to get there on time. I'd be sitting here. I'm doing exactly the same thing now. I still bicycle very fast into campus. Only thing is, I go to the podium and try to talk. But it's in that something never changes. What I think.
So one thing I would like to ask is, since you have spent quite a bit of time abroad, good universities.
Yes.
In your opinion, how do you rate the standard in IIT Madras with those universities? Do you think that whatever ranking is being given, is it a proper ranking or is it improper? In the sense, IIT should have been ranked better or worse? What is it, your opinion?
So my answer to that, there are two aspects, of course, and we always do view them separately. One is undergraduate student. The quality and education. In that, I would say, we definitely are up there in terms of the quality of students we have and the education that we give them. One significant difference between an undergraduate education here and, say, any good university in the US, at least what I've seen, is the amount of homework and out-of-class work that we give. So that's one very significant difference, and which we don't do as much here. So that is one aspect. But otherwise, in terms of the quality of the education, the work course that is taught, in terms of the students, in fact, several times the students here are far brighter than even the best universities that I have at least seen, the undergraduates there. Now, regarding quality of research, definitely, especially now, I mean, research has also been given a lot of prominence. And I see a lot of colleagues who are really doing cutting edge research. And if at all, I think we face some difficulty in rankings. It is because of some of the environmental issues, such as, you know, equipment availability sometimes is a little bit the downtime for equipment is much more. Like if somebody is doing some experimental stuff, if something goes broken, it takes 3 months, 6 months to fix it. Whereas in US, it's done overnight or in a couple of days. So because of this, there's some natural issues that come out of that. Otherwise, you know, I would say, I mean, I'm really excited about the research environment that we are seeing as in terms of our colleagues' output and so on. So it's really
your opinion.
I would agree with that. So my own background, most of my grad studies was in the US as well as working there. So what I notice is definitely at the undergraduate level, I think I agree with Srikanth, the training as well as the courses, the exposure that we give them is right up there. There's just no doubt about it. Somehow the US universities, for example, that I know of, are able to take it to the next level at the graduate, even including the way the students think. I think, as he mentioned, things like homework and assignments, projects, out-of-class work that the students do in their undergraduate, help them take it to the next level when they go for grad studies. So when it comes to the research portion, the students are able to take it to the next level. I think maybe if we include some of that at our undergraduate level, it will help us kind of, you know, take the rankings to the next level also. Apart from that, I think part of these rankings definitely, I can imagine that, you know, things like just raw amount of money research money that goes into, for example, US universities is probably going to be, you know, one level higher just because they have so much more money as a society, as a country. So if that figures into the rankings, it probably will not, you know, it will affect us poorly, right? But we are now taking steps, right? Now there is a lot more funding from the government, from private sources and so on. So I think the future looks very bright as far as we are concerned.
Why I'm asking you is, you see, after all, IIT Madras is only going to be 60 years old, but those universities are much older.
Of course.
And
of course.
So the reputation they have built up.
They have built up is much, much
now
better.
Now, we also possibly will build up the same reputation.
Definitely.
Every time we come up to that level. You agree with that?
Yes, sure. I completely agree with that.
That's all I have.
Definitely.
Thank you. Thank you.